This is our introduction to a study. So normally those are more provocative classes. So the idea is that we provoke thought, that I kickstart brains, kickstart hearts, kickstart spirits, so that we're starting to move forward in this subject. So welcome to everybody. Welcome to and through the Church of Jesus Christ, more directly the Church of Jesus Christ in Oldham County, Kentucky. But when I look at this cross-section of brothers, sisters, and friends, Kentucky can't hold all the people on this call. So it's very, very exciting to see everybody who's out there. So welcome to the Church of Jesus Christ. Always, and I'm not going to pause too long here, you're always invited to join us if you have no landing spot on Sunday mornings. We're on Eastern time. Much of Kentucky is not, but we are. We maintain an Eastern time zone. I don't know if we're going to continue to change or not. Right now, they're telling us that we might be locked in to this time. So I don't know. But as of now, we're Eastern time zone at 10:30. When I say we, I mean the entire country. I believe the government is making decisions on whether or not we're going to go back and forth with daylight savings time. Also, if you want to, if you miss something on a Wednesday, miss something on a Tuesday, or miss something on a Sunday, we always, or at least try to always, post our videos put them into both our Facebook page and our YouTube page. So you can always go there and go to classes from before or services from before. I usually pause on the open sharing only because with a complete understanding, I have posted a few where the discussions are open, and one or two have asked me not to when they're involved, and I want to respect that. So I normally don't. As an example, last week we finished up a study of 7 weeks, I believe, and it was all open dialogue, absolutely wonderful. But again, I didn't feel the liberty to post that particular video. So just bear with us on that one. But you will get your Sundays in and Tuesday nighters. So again, welcome to our Tuesday nighters, to all of you. And if you haven't been a Tuesday nighter, you're invited to be a Tuesday nighter. I heard Logan explaining to Sister Terry Lynn about his Tuesdays have been filled with volleyball. And you would have to meet this tall, thin, handsome young man to understand why he and should be playing volleyball. So having said that, we certainly give him a pass on Tuesday nights and think that's exactly where he's supposed to be. So we get that one. So for the rest of you, if you're not playing volleyball, we're thrilled to have you as regulars. And Logan, we wish no injuries on you, but should you sprain an ankle, you're always invited back on Tuesday nights. So let's get started to a brand new study tonight. For those who haven't been on a first day of any class, more questions than answers. My thought is to get you leaning in on the class, get you at least getting anxious to participate and excited about the class. So that's the intention for our first class in any series. So this is our first class in this particular study. This study being Stop, Collaborate, and Listen. And I'm just going to make this note, the musical phrase should be, could be, can be, and hopefully is utilized by any different thinking group of people as a tool if they have the desire to explore, to experience, and then exhibit some sustained unity. And this particular study, a complete sustained unity, and you'll see that show up on a couple pages. I don't know if this will work, but I sure hope so. See if it does on your side.
Yo, VIP. Let's kick it.
Collaborate and listen. I sit back with my brand new invention. Something grabs a hold of me.
I hope you were able to hear that. I practiced that a couple times before we came on tonight, so I hope you were able to hear. So unity. We are planning to move forward and explore as much, if not all, of the phrase, the word, the intention of unity. But I say this openly, it's quite a daunting endeavor. In fact, it might even be unwise as an effort, as it most likely will fail for anyone who tries to find unity. And you'll see by way of tonight, this is not intended to be a negative class, but instead to be a realistic class, so that we understand how we do in this subject when left to our own devices. So that if we start looking towards unity, we know there's only one source that could possibly help us succeed. So a deep dive into the how-to of individually minded people might come together, how they could come together in a total one-mindedness seems doubtful at best. The irony of this class, the intimidation of this class, may easily result in these 1 hour sessions, our being unable to arrive at total unity in simply identifying and agreeing upon how any group can arrive at total unity. So we may not even accomplish unity in deciding how to get to unity. We're going to begin our study with a simple hope of comprehending and then appreciating the rareness of the phenomenon unity. So for some of you, if you've experienced unity momentarily, maybe in a meeting, maybe if you've attended some weekend conference or even a week-long conference or camp, you might be leaning forward, believing that a people are able to become united. And I love that. That's where we have to start. But consider this, as some have attained this amazing miracle for a moment or two, does this actually equate to sustaining that level of unification? Unity, accord, agree, harmony, oneness. It's a state of being joined together, normally in a common understanding, a singular, undivided entity. Now listen to this, seen as complete, seen as whole, seen as absolute. Complete unity, whole unity, absolute unity. How much accord, how much agreement, how much harmony, how much oneness do any of us over an entire lifespan truly experience? How often? I would say this, so little that we remember those moments of unity. How often are we a part of any undivided entity? Think of the word that we used, the last word we used on that last slide to define unity. It was absolute, absolute unity. Most certainly, unity is a rare phenomenon in anyone's life experience. Let's go through just a couple examples. Consider our country's name, the United States of America. And I want you to just ask yourself this, and this is not to be negative, this is just to make an assessment. Is this, the greatest country in the world, truly unified? Maybe, I think maybe in generalities, certainly in a general philosophy that we want to be free, but maybe no more than just ideals. It's in the areas of separation that unity can even feel unreachable. Is it the specific subject matters that separate us? Or is it the feeling of rightness that both sides, whatever the subject is, embrace as their own? And is that what makes the distance between such separation so great? Consider your communities. And remember what a community is. It's often defined by people of like-mindedness coexisting, watch this, in a defined area or organization. When Candace and I and the children first moved to Kentucky, we had never played soccer in our lives. Didn't didn't know anything about soccer, and our children became involved in indoor soccer. And before a couple years was over, Candace and I were both involved in leagues in soccer, a community within a community. We mentioned earlier, Logan said on Tuesday nights he plays volleyball in a league. A community within his college community. So it's not just geographic. Sometimes those communities are defined by literally the same desire, like-mindedness. Now, having said that, consider your communities, whether geographic or by some organization. Are they unified? These mini societies that we belong to, they're normally established by ethnicity, and I'm thinking of large urban cities, ethnicity, color, creed, or in an organization, or purpose, intended on gathering similar or same like-minded people. So how is it, even in our communities, we've gone from a nation to a community, how is it that even our communities aren't necessarily unified? Consider your workplace. Consider your work co-workers. Do you feel unification there? And these spaces that we dwell within, Candace and I drove behind a gentleman who must have been a laborer of some sort. There was wood sticking out the back of his truck. And I remember installing kitchen cabinets as a young person and getting to the workplace, and all the people there had similar or same goals. I had to get a kitchen finished. Someone else was doing walls. Someone else was painting. All of us in this shared space with common goals. And often these workspaces are defined by people of similar or same desires, similar or same talents. I'm thinking of Brother Ken, who has been in marketing as an artist for so long. Creatives working amongst creatives. You might go to an architecture firm and you'll find analyticals coexisting with analyticals. And so it is, right brains working with right brains, left brains working with left brains. It seems that we are often surrounded by same thinking people. Given this mutual makeup, surely unity is prevalent in these settings. But we know this, an opportunity to succeed doesn't always manifest with success. Now, consider your neighbors, your neighborhood, those living nearby or even next door or at least adjacent. Are you currently enjoying unity with even those who are next door to you? So many never reach this lofty expectation. I think of Tool Time Tim, who used to lean against his fence and talk to his neighbor in complete agreement. Not rarely, but not everybody enjoys such relationships. Some never reach this lofty expectation that's out there. And sometimes it's for the simplest reasons. They cut their grass wrong. Their fence is touching my grass. They paint their house in a color that I don't enjoy, and it makes the neighborhood look bad. They don't cut their grass enough. They don't trim their bushes, whatever it is. Too often the simplest reasons keep us apart. And consider this, we choose where we live. And when we choose that, we certainly don't hope for discord. We hope for the best in our relationships, in the events, in the occurrences. Once we move into this home, and for some of us, for years and years and years, I was thinking just the other day, I've been in this home longer than I've been in any other home in my life. Am I in total unity with my neighbors? Consider your friends. Do you remain in unity? Do you maintain perfect cohesiveness 100% of the time? And again, understanding this, we choose these individuals. Of all the people you encounter, you handpick a certain group that you call, quote, friends. and even close friends. And then you allow this subset into your heart. Again, deemed friends. Do you remain unified with them? Certainly, we have to be able to maintain unity with those that we select. And to drive the point home that it's so hard to remain unified, how many childhood friends are still not acquaintances, but close friends? Consider your family. And I'm not delving into your life and getting into your home. I want you to consider, almost rhetorically, your family. Do you delight today, completely enjoy absolute unity? Bring it closer. Keep it as only your immediate family. Because sometimes when we define our family too large, we can't quite control distant relations, distant family members, just your immediate family. Can you confirm absolute, because that's what the definition was, absolute unity with your immediate family? Why is it, even with our own families, that unity is so difficult to maintain? Do you find that it's because of them in all these examples I've given you? Whether it's the country, those who lean this way, those who look like this, those who speak this way in your communities, those on that side of the community, those that sit on that side of the room in my organization, my community, those on the other soccer team? Is it always them that cause disunity? Consider your friends. They've changed with years. They're not who they used to be. Your family, same. Consider all of these, your coworkers. Is it always them? Or is it just what it is? Unity is so difficult. Consider your branch or mission. Are you and your brothers and sisters unified in all ways? Maybe a subject or two. It's possible that not much more than that. Is it possible to be truly unified? Is it even necessary? But this, listen to this. What is it that we have in common? At least the starting point. What do we share together? It's our love for the Lord. But if we allow this to happen, even that can cause rifts. Maybe we're not equal in how much we love him. Maybe we don't show our love for him the same. And maybe that creates opportunities to judge, or it causes separation. Could it be that even our love, if we allow it, can separate us from one another? Unity. Surely, at the very least, mankind can maintain this high standard of oneness, of pure and complete accord with those individuals that we love and that we choose to love most. Maybe family, because we've been born into family. Those aren't our choices. Maybe friends have changed. Maybe our communities, we moved in not knowing everyone like we hoped we would. Maybe all of these have good excuse, but what about those that we love and choose to love? As we say, till death do us part. At least we're able to maintain that unity, offering no judgment, just facts. Approximately 41% of first marriages end in divorce. 4 of every 10 marriages end in divorce. That number jumps to 60%, or just about 60%, just less than 60% for second marriages. So now the 4 and the 6 switch. 6 out of 10 second marriages end in divorce. It gets worse. Third marriages, almost 3 out of every 4 end in divorce. Those we love and we choose to love most. though still willing to give it one more try, 83%. It's actually 83.6% of fourth marriages end in divorce. Discouraging. When you consider our quest is to celebrate not attaining unity, but maintaining unity. That's what this class is all about. And it seems that 40%, 60%, 75%, almost 85% can't do that. With those that are chosen to love most. So when given it to us, when the responsibility to unify is ours and ours alone, we can see we're not that good at this. Is this discouragement? Or is this all laid out tonight so that we know when we do experience unity, if we do experience this unity, it's all to the honor and glory of God. It goes hand in hand with the phrase that I have exhausted with you. Man is built to fail. Man is intended to succeed. When given to his own, he is joyless. When God comes in and rescues, he is intended for joy and has joy only through God. So with these levels of failure throughout country, community, region, families, friends, marriages, we're just not good at this when left to our own devices. With this consistency of failure in attempting to experience some form of unity, in all these multiple opportunities, workplaces, families, homes, organizations, why would Jesus then establish such an unfair, unrealistic, and unreachable, or at least seemingly unreachable goal for his followers when he prayed to his Father specifically for his followers? He said this, that they may be one, that they may be unified, that they may dwell in one accord, that they may dwell in harmony as you, or thou, as you, Father, are in me and as I am in you, that they, our followers, may be one in us. This is the established goal. Whether we deem it unfair, whether we deem it unrealistic, whether we deem it unreachable, it is our established goal. It is the expectation. It is the high standard that we are called to reach. Unity. So this is the direction we're going to be headed for the next couple weeks. We're going to try to discover the how, what, when, and where. We know what the who is. The who is us. And we're going to try to delve into how we can not just attain, but certainly attain as a starting point. And then maintain, and then sustain this miraculous condition. And I ask you this, could it really be just this easy? Because my theory is an oversimplification. Stop, collaborate, and listen. That's where we're going over the next couple weeks. So tonight for our discussion, here's what I want you to think about. So that